Okay, good afternoon, everyone. So you can see by the title, the main point of the talk was to analyze observations that already exist that other people have collected. So there's a huge database of observations of various variable stars, including Betelgeuse and many others, and a big database called the American Association of Variable Star Observers. I just took a wild guess that a lot of you have probably heard of that already. Is that true? Have most of you heard of it? Okay, I could ask a quick poll. Or some of you have been or are members of AAVSO? So a lot of hands up. Okay, good. So I don't need to introduce it too much. And so I'll just mention a few little details about variable star observing, especially as they apply to the observations of Betelgeuse. And so probably I don't need to tell you where Betelgeuse is or tell you how to find it. And you probably don't even need a star chart or an app to find Betelgeuse. And so most people know where it is. And so I wouldn't explain very much. I should explain that there are finder charts, as they're called, available that you can print out from the AAVSO for Betelgeuse or any other variable star. And so the point there is that there are various stars marked with different magnitudes. And Betelgeuse is a very special, complicated star to get observations on. Are there any nearby comparison stars? And so being a 0 to 1 magnitude star, it limits the range of local stars you can use for comparisons. And this is pretty slow, isn't it? I wonder if it's just delayed or slow. Okay, so as far as equipment that's been used, so the picture on the left was intended to be a pair of eyes. So I found a cartoon of a pair of eyes, and so that's why you see a picture of a telescope there, or do you need binoculars to make observations of Betelgeuse, a first magnitude star? So I just put a picture to represent eyes alone, because a lot of observations have been collected just by eyes alone. No telescope, no binoculars. The instrument on the right, just by survey, any of you know what that instrument is? Recognize it? A few hands go up, very good. A lot of hands go up, okay, glad to hear it. Because that's 1980s era photoelectric photometer. And so it might sound like it ought to have been retired by now. Mine, it's almost 30 years old. I decided a few years ago that it's time to retire it, replace it with CCD photometry, except hopefully I'll convince you in this presentation that I'm gonna continue using this probably for the rest of my life. So a few little details about variable star observing. One would be, why would we bother to observe variable stars? And my personal perspective is that it's interesting and challenging, and pretty often it's fun. It may not be fun in some cases, but how do you do it? It's really basically as simple as comparing a variable star with a brighter star and a fainter star and interpolating, saying this is what the magnitude is. So that sounds really easy. Are there any errors? Errors can creep in when you say, wait a minute, I'm looking at my telescope field of view and there are no comparison stars that are brighter or fainter. Or it's they're way outside of the field of view, or it's near its brightest magnitude range. Say, for instance, a star that varies from, say, 7 to 13 magnitude. When it's brightest, it's pretty bright and there are no comparison stars nearby. What do you do then? You estimate it, of course, but there's potential for errors to creep in. Or what if it's near the fainter limit of your telescope? Supposing I'm using a 6-inch scope and that 12th magnitude star is near 12th magnitude and there's a full moon in the sky and there's a bit of haze and that darn forest fire smoke of Alberta is drifting overhead. I live in southern Ontario, by the way. And your darn neighbor's porch light is causing some light interference. And so there's potential for some errors at both a brighter range and a fainter range. But anyway, I thought I'd start off with a few examples that you may be familiar with, just to introduce what I'm trying to show here. So probably you've all heard of Mira. It's one of the most famous variable stars. And so probably the prototype red supergiant variable star. And so you may know it varies from approximately magnitude 2 to 9, and it's in the autumn sky mostly. And it's a fairly common starting object. And so if you plot a light curve of Mira, and I just put some credits on the images, but this is a screenshot off the AAVSO website. So if you go on the AAVSO website, you can type in the star you want and ask it for a light curve, and it plots it. And so here it's plotted a few periods, a couple of years, 2.5 years. But the point here is that you see the light curve, and if you're not familiar with it, date increases along the right, along the x-axis, and vertically you see the brightness. So lower magnitude at the top, lower magnitude is brighter and fainter or higher magnitude is at the bottom. So in this case, it varies from approximately magnitude 2.5 down to about 9.5, very roughly. But the point of this light curve, you can see at a glance what the period is. You see a few periods plotted here. And it so happens that it has a period of approximately 330 days, and so that doesn't coincide exactly with the year, so that any light curve, you'll lose some data for several months when it's near the sun, and you can't get observations. And so, but otherwise, you can see at a glance, you can pick out a period. And the other detail to point out on this is that the errors are fairly small. So you pick any, I think if you pick a laser pointer, and it works, if you pick any spot, pick any date, the range of observations that people have reported, various observers have reported, is fairly tightly constrained here. So it's pretty good. So you can look at this and say, confidently say what the period is and a lot of other details. So pick another example that you may or may not be familiar with, Eta Aquilae. So the point here is that it varies in magnitude from about 3.5 to 4.5, and quite a bit more scatter in the visual observations, you might agree. So you pick any date, and there is quite a range of magnitudes that people have reported. So does that give you any confidence? It gives you less confidence, maybe, but the point is about the errors, is errors are extremely important to watch out for. That's the other problem of a brighter star. Are there any nearby comparisons that make it easy or practical to get a good, solid, reliable magnitude estimate? I wanted to use the VSTAR analysis software that's on the AAVSO website. And so when I use this one, you see a fairly similar picture to what I just showed you. So here I've loaded the observations. It's the raw data on the VSTAR plot page. So one detail I want to use is the phase plot. And so you see that it's sort of periodic. And so a phase might extend from, say, maximum to maximum. And so if you were to take all the observations back many years, of course, and take 100 of these or more and line them all up onto one particular phase, you get a so-called phase plot. But here's what it looks like when you use the software to plot a phase plot. So this is taking all those observations and many more and putting them all into one phase. And it's picked a phase, picked one period that's in its database. You may not be able to read it, that's fine, but take my word for it. It's just a period. In this case, it's 7.17 days, and that's just its database value that it chooses for a period. We can pick any period we want, of course, but you see how a phase plot lines all the observations up with beginning or end of the, or minimum or maximum or whatever you want to use for the phase, and makes it really easy to see at a glance what's going on. And you can still also get some idea what the errors are. But that's the phase plot. I thought I'd give you one more example before we get into Betelgeuse, another fairly well-known variable star. Algol, probably everyone's familiar with that, and you probably don't need a chart or an app to find it. That's fairly well-known. It's a different sort of variable star because it's an eclipsing binary. So the point of the raw observations is that you, there's a fair bit of error here, but it, every few days, 2.5 days or so, it drops to about a magnitude and a half. So if we plot a phase plot for this, it's far more clear. Hopefully, you can see at a glance what's going on there. And so, yes, there's some scatter in some of the observations, not sure what's going on there, but at a glance, you can see how most of the observations line up and make a fairly clear, distinct cycle. So that's Algol. So if you go on to Betelgeuse, one detail to point out is it's known as a semi-regular supergiant. So supergiants are interesting by themselves. You know, they're gigantic stars, and Paul's model that he had this morning, stretching out to approximately Saturn, represents approximately the distance that Betelgeuse would occupy if it were where the sun is. It would come out to somewhere between the Mars, the orbits of Mars or Jupiter or Saturn. It's that huge of a star. So for a star that's 30 solar masses and about 600 light years distance, it's got to be interesting. But when we see it semi-regular, described as semi-regular, we ought to be cautious about looking for one simple period that will simply explain it. So you may have seen David Turner's poster outside had a very good phrase on it. It's the challenge is to find a reliable period. So reliable, subjective term. So let's see what happens here. So we just got a raw data plot of some data, and so you see at a glance, or I see at a glance, the way I interpret this, that's quite a mess. There's quite a range of, a range isn't really the way to put it, a big mess of errors from you know, approximately zero down to almost second magnitude for any particular date. And so this spanning quite a few years, it's really also a tribute to early observers 1920s or 1930s that made really tight, good observations, but you can see in recent decades, that's quite a mess. And so, but if we look at an even longer period, this is an interesting plot that I found that plots approximately 80 years of observations of Betelgeuse as they've been reported to the AVSO, and it's in their database. So it's ranging, so you may not see the dates, but it starts off, a label up here says approximately 1926, and date increases this way across each row. So the point is that can you pick out a regular period? Pick a maximum to a maximum? Probably not. Do you see a steady magnitude range, or do you see quite a difference in magnitudes? So there's quite a big variation in this star. Straightforward, but I want to look at it with V-star. But I could just say, if I back up a bit, it may be dangerous to do that, don't know, but sometimes left arrow does it. It does, so when I first look at this, I could say, that's quite a filthy mess of observations. Do I really want to spend time analyzing it? Oh, did I tell you how much I'm being paid to do this, by the way? So do I really want to waste my time analyzing this? Or could I just walk away from it and do something easier to look at? Well, we've got some interesting software tools here on the AVSO website, so I'm going to explore it as far as I can. So I'm going to keep going on it. So I'm going to load it into VSTAR. To do that, it's just a piece of software on the website of the AVSO, and under data analysis and VSTAR, and it loads. And so press a few buttons and then press a few more buttons to load the observations that are in the database. And here you get the picture I just showed you earlier. And so visual observations, date spanning quite a few years, and you see, especially in later years, it's the past several decades, quite a mess there, and I have to decide, do I really want to spend my time on this? Yeah, maybe, maybe not. So I'm going to try a phase plot, just as what I showed you for Ada Aquila or Algol. So does this help at all? So it looks up in its database, what is its database period? 2,335 days, then it's trying to plot a phase plot. So does that look like a regular phase plot to you? I think it's quite a mess. However, there are some observations that may be a little bit better, and did I plot them here? I think I plotted them in the previous one. Let's see, it might have been here. The point is that they're plotting visual observations. There are some other observations in the database. There are hundreds of observations called photoelectric observations have been made for the past 30 years or so. Why do I mention them? If I say I don't like the scatter in your observations here, pick any date, and the range of observations that have been submitted by many observers covers quite a huge range for any particular date. But I know by experience that the photoelectric observations in the database have an error of 0.01 magnitude or better. So they're accurate to better than 1/100 of a magnitude. And so, when I started doing photoelectric photometry for the AVSO in approximately mid or late 1980s, the guy that was in charge of the program said, if the error on each observation is more than or worse than 1/100 of a magnitude, don't bother submitting it. So I know that by experience that the photoelectric observations in the database are pretty darn accurate. So why don't I just look at them? And so here's the problem. I'm not sure if there's a distinct period, and there's a heck of a lot of scatter in the visual data. So if I just analyze the Johnson V data, and that's the name in the database, V-band data, Johnson V-band is just the name of the filter that we use on the photometry. And so they call it Johnson V data. And so here's the plot of all the data again. This is what I was looking for earlier. The visual data is in black, and these, I'm not sure if the color scheme shows up, but from approximately here onward, we see more and more of these Johnson V or photoelectric data. So why don't I just plot them, see what happens, in case I consider them to be more confident. So here's, when I separated out, just plot those data, here's what I get. So maybe it's a bit more precise, maybe not. Why don't I plot a phase plot? So here's the phase plot for it. That looks to me a bit more confident, inspiring. Looks a little bit more realistic than the plot I showed earlier, which had a huge amount of scatter. So that's fine. Now why don't I plot a power spectrum? So the power spectrum looks through the, is a software that looks through, tries to pick out a period. And you can see that you can plot, if you back up a little bit, you can plot for any particular set of data a period of 1 day or 1,000 days or 100 days or anything in between and make it fit. and find some data that fit your period. So the power spectrum plots all that, and it picks out the periods that best fit the data. And so sometimes it's easier to show you than to holler about it. So why don't I just plot it using the software and the Johnson V data. So here's the power spectrum. And so it's actually plotting frequency. You may or may not be able to read the axes, but frequency is just one over period. And so low frequency, high period. But you see at a glance, the software is picking out one or two or three high power or high confidence periods. So why don't I just look at these? So to do that, I'm going to plot it in tabular format. So I'm just going to click on this button that says top hits. And when we do that, we get a table. And table plots it out in tabular format. So I've scribbled for you in the side there, the top hit shows 377 days for the best fit period. And so that's quite a bit different from what I was looking at. So why don't I plot the phase plot using that period? And there's what I get. And to me, it looks more reasonable and quite a bit more realistic and dominant mode. But the overall point is that it's far more confident than the earlier picture I was looking at. So heck of a lot of more analysis I could do, but one other idea I could do is use this technique of power spectrum on all that visual data. So I'll just finish off showing you what happens if I do that. So pick the visual data, plot the power spectrum, very different power spectrum. Here's the table, and just fast forwarding here, but go to the end, and there's one of the lines that coincides with approximately near 2335 days, which is in the database, and of 2565 days. Now, admittedly, every time I plot this, every day I plot this, there's a different set of numbers that show up, and it's there, you know, plus or minus several hundred, but generally it's around 6 years, this period here. But why don't I take that period, plot the phase plot using that period? That looks sort of reasonable, although it's a visual data, so that's fine. Why don't I add the Johnson V data to that now? And so now, using that period and the Johnson V data, or photoelectric data, I get a fairly respectable looking, complicated, I know, for period analysis, but a much better looking phase plot. So that's a brief summary of what I can do by looking at this. So I know we're out of time, and so I'm just going to summarize that little bit of tiny bit of analysis that I've done. And so the photoelectric data is pretty darn precise because it's 0.01 magnitude or better. And using that data, I pull out a period of 377 days. I have to caution that we always have to be careful if there's a period near 1 year, because there's some artifacts to get into it. But with photoelectric data, I'm pretty confident in a lot of aspects of it. Anyway, visual data, a lot of scatter, yes, but this period of 2565 days may be pretty reasonable. And so how do I compare that with some literature values? So I picked out a reference that was 30 years old, and so 30 years ago it was published that the period was analyzed to be in this range, a little shy of 6 years. So this was known 30 years ago, so it's nothing new that I'm telling you, I'm just really confirming what was known 30 years ago. And also 20 years ago, in the era of the International Ultraviolet Explorer satellite, a researcher found a period of 420 days, so that's fairly close maybe to 377 days. So there are various modes of variability here, various modes of variability, and we can pick some of them out. More work to be done, and we can do more analysis. We can check for composite periods, and we can see there have been published papers about planets found or suspected to be orbiting Betelgeuse, and there are circumstellar shells and disks and so on that complicate the thing quite a bit. So that's why I say we can't really expect to find one period that describes all these observations. So that's fine. I'm just finishing off with future steps. There's tons of interesting research about any particular star. If you want to look into one star, it's really, really interesting. And Betelgeuse is very interesting by itself. But all I'm doing is looking at observations that already exist in a database and see what I can do with them. To me, it means I ought to keep using that photometer. So this one's mine on one of my backyard scopes, and I'm going to keep using it for the rest of my life. I'm going to keep doing all these observations of Betelgeuse because it's really the only way to get good observations of Betelgeuse that could be pretty darn useful in decades ahead. So to me, a lot of interesting stuff ahead in astronomy. So thank you for your attention.